Good evening and welcome to another session in our Tuesday Folk People series. For those of you who don't know, my name is Maddie and I'm one of the Folk Club hosts here at Homestage, and I'm going to be presenting the session this evening, and I'm very lucky to be doing so because we've got some fantastic artists here today. For the first half hour, we're going to welcome Celtic Conundrum all the way from across the Atlantic, with backgrounds in a range of different music styles. We've got classical, jazz, blues, rock, and obviously folk. They're going to be showing us their unique sound. I've not heard anything like it, and obviously we will go more into detail with that in that half hour. I don't want to spoil it now. For the second half, we are going to be welcoming Geoff Wilson a little bit closer to home in Manchester. Along with his ukulele, his guitar and his voice, he's going to be telling us all about his musical background and talking to us about the brand new ukulele club that he is hosting for us here at Homestage, the Ukulele String Along Workshop. Anyway, enough of that, let's get on with our first act. So time for Celtic Conundrum. Welcome, Celtic Conundrum. Danny, Pamela and Jean, thank you very much for joining us all the way from the States. It's amazing that we can do this here today. I think that we should probably begin with one of your songs just to give our audience a taste of who we're working with. And we've got first two shots of whiskey and a prayer. Could you sort of quickly just tell us what that song's about?
Two shots of whiskey and a prayer. It's a concept of wrote it for an international film fest that we were starting a concert. It's a song about a person basically being trapped in whatever kind of a building you want to imagine, and they gotta somehow or some reason get away. And so they're hoping that, you know, the joke is that they had two shots of whiskey and a prayer, and they only need the whiskey to get out. So that's it. It's supposed to be fun. That's it. Yeah.
Fab. Let's give it a listen then.
Been holed up here all night because of morning light. Time to run or fight. Got a hope I'll be all right. 'Cause I got two shots of whiskey. Thank you.
you're different still. You're all such different sounds. It's amazing. How did then the band form, seeing as you're all just from this different background? How did it all come together?
About 2016, I think it was, my daughter's was moving to Oregon to go do music out there. And so I suggested that we put together a little band. You know, we didn't see a lot of like Celtic bands or Irish bands at the time. We saw a few. excuse me. So, and just before that summer, just before she left, we ran into Danny, and Danny joined us on stage, and we just kind of went from there. And then Pamela joined later on. So it's just been amazing since.
Well, yeah. Well, you said to me previously when we had our chat before that that Danny, when he was singing with you and your daughter, he had such a powerful voice that the audience could hear it even without a microphone or something.
He came on stage to join us. My daughter and I really used to love to invite people on, and Danny and I had been talking about a week ago before that. So he said, "Okay, I'll come. We'll come join you. You know, play a song or two with you." And he was a good 6 feet behind me to the right.
Oh, 15.
Okay. I was so silly. Yeah, it was a heck of a distance. And he was singing loud enough that he was projecting past my mic. My mic was picking him up. Even without the mic, they could hear him. And it was pretty outstanding. And he was harmonizing with me as he did it.
I mean, have you heard of Meatloaf? Because he can project, and it's sort of reminding me of that projection. That's amazing. If I tried that, I'd lose my voice probably forever. But I mean, listening to even you performing, you can hear the different sounds within that. Because obviously, you can hear Danny, your very powerful, very sort of clear voice, and then Pamela, you've got like this kind of yodel thing that I sort of mentioned to Jean before.
She's very good at yodeling, yes.
It's amazing. You can just hear this sort of blend of different styles, and it's just fab. And I think that we should probably hear that in another song. So I think it's time for your second song, which is "So I'll Remember." Could you tell us a bit about that one before we hear it?
That one's a tribute and homage to kind of what we do and what here in the States and even in England. You know, we have things like medieval fairs and Renaissance fairs, and we have Scottish Highland games here, Irish festivals, Celtic festival. The Italians have San Gennaro in York, and Asians celebrate their New Year. It's all connected to the heritage. The song is just the way to kind of remind us that, you know, that's why we do it and connect to who we do by the family we're with. So
this is an original song, obviously.
Both those are original. I wrote, I'm the primary writer for this band, mostly. But they both are songwriters, too.
Brilliant. Let's give it a go.
On my porch, tired eyes to see, watching the ships as they steam out to sea. My grandchild will be by with her mother's eyes, grandmother's hair, not a worry or care. She sits down by me, a young woman I see, turns towards me, that old sing for me. Sing me the song, sing me the songs of where you're from. So I will remember and carry them on. Sing me the song, sing me the songs of where you're born. So I will remember and carry them on.
Shall we Mentioned the town you live in. Tell me if I'm pronouncing this wrong, but is it Dunedin? Is that,
no,
is that...
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Well, yeah, you mentioned that maybe that's kind of where the Celtic side of your name, Celtic Conundrum, comes from. Could you tell us a bit more about Dunedin? Because I'm fascinated by this town ever since you told me about it.
Well, you have to come visit us then. The running joke, although everyone hates to hear it, the running joke is that Dunedin is a quaint little drinking town with the Celtic problem. In truth, it has a very strong Scottish roots. It's founded by a Scottish people. Dunedin is one of the original names for Edinburgh back in Scotland. And we have four or five city pipe and drum bands. A couple years ago, they took the world's first place in Scotland, where I think grade two. We have two or three in the high school pipe and drum bands, as well as dancers. And then we have like one in the middle school as well.
So is that quite common to have kind of piping things in the schools and in the communities in the US?
No, it's very rare. And in fact, they usually were competing just against adults when they compete.
Wow. So what is it about Dunedin that makes it different? Why is this like a hotbed of Celtic roots, but elsewhere isn't?
We get a lot of people immigrating here from Scotland, come to retire, come to vacation here. We get a lot of people from Canada of Irish and Scottish and English descent because they come to see the Toronto Blue Jays, and because it's warm. I'm not sure what you said behind it.
Oh, we're founded by Scottish.
I mentioned that in the first part, yeah, that we are founded by the Scots, yeah. I think they see the name and then they're connected to that. It's by the water. And then when they come here, they find it's a very quaint little town you can travel to, and makes it a lot of fun. And the music, of course, is kind of pretty important right here. So.
Would you say that having this is the place where you like originate and everything, is that the reason that you've gone into this Celtic sound, or is there another reason for that?
I think it's a bit of a both. I think that definitely had an impact and it had a place. And also it allowed to be more acoustically, because some of the places that when my daughter and I started playing, things we did for festivals, couldn't be amplified. So it wasn't a place for a rock band. And I did the rock band thing. I still like playing like that, but I like doing other things. And Danny and I both dig Celtic. We all do. you know, we did folk music, we did Celtic music, and I liked the ideas of using the world's roots into our music. So yeah, that's why the name Celtic was in there. We wanted to pay an homage to that part, because the music across the pond still happens both ways. And we think that's really great. I think that's amazing, to be honest. So we just can't figure out why Conundrum's in the name.
So Danny, have you been then performing Celtic music all your life, or is that quite a new thing for you?
In high school, there was, you know, in like the Young Singer traditional books, there were some like, you know, Danny Boy and some others that were traditional songs that fit in there. And of course, with my name, you know, everybody expected me to sing them.
You should tell her last name.
But when I came back from touring and stuff, is when I really got into it. I wasn't writing much music my own, and I'm like, what can I record? And I was looking at things that were what they call common domain, and I got out this really old anthology. I mean, literally the pages were falling apart, and took out all the Irish and Scottish and English songs that were traditional ones, and started, that's where I started actually doing that. And then I ran across a friend of ours, Mac Perry, who taught me to play the baron and encouraged that, because he was the president of New World Celts, and so gave me an opportunity to do it, and then he encouraged me and helped me along, and that's how I got into it. Yeah.
Wow. And Pamela, is there a bit of a scene of the Celtic in Alabama, obviously where you're from? Is there that Celtic root?
Most definitely, because, you know, the people who immigrated to North America, a lot of them made their way down to the South. And so we are, you know, descendants of Scottish and Irish and English people from that time. A lot of the names are, you know, English, Irish, Scottish. So you can definitely see that even in the street names. And the music, of course, came with the people and then blended with the people who were here and others, immigrants who came. And so the music developed from that. And so even though maybe my musical background wouldn't be recognized necessarily as Celtic from the time when I was growing up, the music is definitely connected. And I can see that in the lyrics. A lot of the lyrics of the old, you know, the old time songs, we call them old time music, are borrowed from, you know, songs that, ballads and songs that came across with the people who immigrated to North America. So it's all connected. The music is connected and evolved from that.
Yeah, but I'm the only one who grew up in New England, lived in New Britain.
Well, I think that talking about
countries like that. Sorry.
Okay. Talking about this evolving tradition, it really makes me think of your third song, which is an arrangement of the traditional tune South Australia, the shanty South Australia, which I know was collected in the UK in 1888 or something like that. So obviously it's such an ancient song for us. So then to know that you lot are evolving that and creating this new tradition with this tradition that we have over the sea, over the ocean, it's amazing. So I think that we should probably give this one a listen.
Australia. was there one morning when he blew a Halloween and I met Miss Nancy Penn. And found the play, yeah. Oh, well, Roland King, he blew a Halloween. Oh, and here we sing about South Australia.
Great rendition of an old song that I think we all know and love. So thank you for that. And that has really sort of made me want to learn a bit more about your sound, because your sound isn't just about the Celtic side of it, is it? Jean, you mentioned to me before that it's like a fusion, isn't it? If you could go into a bit more detail, that'd be great.
Yeah, it is. We take a lot of bands where you take the kind of concepts of music you kind of enjoy to grow up with, and so obviously we have a Celtic influence, and we pay homage, and we pay tribute to songs, and we do songs that are still from the traditional end. We just kind of tweak them a bit to have what fits how we play and do what we do. And then the songs I write are kind of, the whole initial concept of this was that I was looking at the fact that most of these songs that we sing were all back in England, back in Ireland, back in Scotland, or they were coming to America, or they'd come to Australia, they'd come to Canada, and then the song stopped. But the story didn't stop. The whole story kept going on. And, you know, that's kind of a lot of our songs are written about or written towards, and that sort of vein is that the story continues here in America. America has, though it's not recognized as one of the Celtic seven nations, it definitely has huge Celtic roots. Just, and so I think it was kind of neat to kind of write songs that kind of went into that point. And that was like back to the So I'll Remember song that's actually connected into that.
Yeah, because America's amazing because you've had so many different cultures come in. I mean, you've got obviously the Celtic, you've got Italian, you've got so many different cultures that you could create just this fusion of sounds that is just so unique. And I think that's what you guys have done, is you've managed to just almost, I think you could say that I'm going a bit far with this, but you've almost managed to get the sound of the diversity of America and put it out there in this unique tradition. I think it's amazing. And that's what I get from your music anyway, even if it's just me.
Well, thank you very much. That's awesome. We're glad you feel that way. We really do.
That's amazing. No, thank you. So, Pamela, when you get a tune, like a new song, maybe one that Gene's written or something, how is it that you take it and you add sort of your part to it, like the banjo or the instrument you're doing? What is your process in that?
So if it's a song I'm going to sing, I first want to hear it. I have to have Gene sing it to me because he's the songwriter. So I want to honor, you know, what he wrote the song for and how he hears the song. But then I take it and add my voice to it and really have to evolve it to fit my style of singing and my phrasing and that sort of thing. Usually the instrument, whether it's banjo or guitar, depends on the song and the rhythm, for example, of the song. And maybe if it's more upbeat, it might have banjo. If it's, you know, a fun song or something, it might be banjo. If it's a more serious song or a deep song, it might be more appropriate for guitar. So it depends on the song itself. But it is a process for me to adapt it to my way of singing and my style to really feel, you know, comfortable with it and with the phrasing and make it my own. It's still Gene's. Gene wrote the song, but it becomes sort of mine through that process. It's an interpretation, I guess.
Yeah. And would you say that's the same for you, Danny? Do you go through the same sort of process?
Similar. Yeah, I learned how he's visualizing it. And usually I have to take a few words out and make them implied and not, because he likes to put a lot of words in there. So I usually have to take a couple words out here and there or change them to mean the same thing. But I very much make it my own, personalize it. Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. Sadly, we are running out of time now, but honestly, we could go on all day about this amazing tradition that you've created. Because what we're trying to do here at Homestage is show off all the different folk styles that are out there. And I think that we've come across something here that is just, it's so unique. And so being able to show that to our audience is amazing. So thank you so much, guys, for joining us. We'd love to have you back because there's more we want to say. So thank you very much. And I think we've got our final song to sort of see us out. And that is Wherever You May Roam. Could you just tell us very briefly what this one's about?
Really fast. My daughter went to go play in France, the jazz thing, and she was still a teenager. So it just, when she just reminded me when you travel across the pond. And so anybody has anyone who's far away from them now, that's kind of what it's about.
Oh, I think that's really relevant with the whole situation with the pandemic now. You've got people far away that you can't really see. So this will be very fitting. Thank you, guys. Good luck to you.
Good night.
Cold and alone, the fire it warms your bones, and wherever you
Celtic Conundrum, what a pleasure to have you. It's amazing. Anyway, we must move on and fly over the sea to Manchester. So we should welcome Geoff Wilson. Welcome, Geoff. Thank you for joining us. We are going to begin with your first song, which is Dirty Old Town. Can you tell us a bit about it, please?
Yeah, Dirty Old Town. It's I live up here in Manchester. Dirty Old Town is a song that was written by Ewan McColl about the city or town of Salford, which is only about 3 or 4 miles away from me. He was writing about the old smoky town and the factories and the manufacturing. And there were, I think, 9 docks at Salford. So a very cosmopolitan place, totally 1 million miles away from what he wrote about.
I met my love by the gasworks broad. Dreamed a dream by the old canal. I kissed my girl by the factory wall. Dirty old town, dirty old town. Clouds are drifting across the moon. Cats are prowling on their beat. Springs a girl from the streets at night. Dirty old town, dirty old town. Heard a siren from the docks, saw the train set the night on fire. I smelled the spring on the smoky wind. Dirty old town, shining steel, tempered in the fire. I'll chop you down like an old dead tree. Dirty old town, dirty old town. I met my love by the gasworks cross. Dreamed a dream by the old canal. I kissed my girl by the factory wall. Dirty old town, dirty old town.
Thank you.
So, Geoff, could you tell me a bit about your musical background, like where you all began?
When I was a teenager, I mean, I got into sort of music very, very early. I was sort of knocking around pub talent shows when I was about 16 or 17. Just by chance, my mum took me out, I think, to some party in a pub, and I thought, cracky, is this what goes on, you know? And I shouldn't have really been in pubs at that time, but very quickly, I began singing on the competitions, just sort of covers and pop songs that were around at the time in the sort of, you know, 70s. And out of the blue, somebody came and said, like, you need to come to town, you know, there's some really good clubs. And like an idiot, like, I went down to all the dives in town at like 17 or 18 years of age. And I became, I mean, this isn't a claim to fame, I became probably the youngest compere in the nightclubs that were open till 2 in the morning. And I was only like 18, and you shouldn't have gone in there till 21. But I was just singing and sort of introducing acts, and I got to know a lot of people. Now, that went on to develop. I went to down to Norfolk, believe it or not, and I became a blue coat for Pontins. So, like, we did loads of entertainment shows and sort of showcases and things like that. Dead naff when I think about it now, but, you know, it was a start. And I got spotted by one of the bands that I used to do the lighting for in the nightclub at Pontins Circuit. And they said, like, come and sing with us for a couple of nights, you know. And I ended up joining this band, and I went on the road for 2 or 3 years as a frontman singer, never played an instrument. Anyway, cut a long story short, things came up. I got married, I settled down in Manchester where I live and where I was born and bred. And the musical thing really didn't continue. I just couldn't afford to do it. I didn't have the backing to go to any college or uni at that time, and I really wanted to study music. So I went into food, and I've been a foodie and chef and researcher and consultant for years and years now, most of my life. Music and food, what could be better?
I was thinking I
knocked about with bands, and I've had many, many friends in the business, but on the rock circuit, you know, mainly. And I've always loved the background thing to music, you know, what goes on behind the scenes before the band come out, and the building of the stage and setting up equipment and recording techniques and things like that. So that's where I am with music. And right out of the blue, from I retired just a few years ago and took early retirement, and I started just picking up my guitar again and bought a ukulele, and it's sort of just dabbling everything, really. I mean, I like to compose stuff and put stuff together with keyboards and in a little studio set up upstairs and things like that, and electronically. So that's an interest, but I don't really aim at doing anything with it. But basically, I think when home stage arrived, I thought, wow, this is really good, because it was like I saw one thing. I think I saw Warwick's appearance on the Tuesday Folk at first, and I thought, crikey, this is good. You know, these are unknown people. And I started following it, and before I knew it, you started the folk club on the Sunday.
Well, I was going to say that I've heard of a lot of people who've said that during their youth and things, they were very into their music, they were dedicated to their music. To the point where you settle down, you have your family, and then you get this stable job, and it's sort of like the music just takes a back seat. But yeah, Everyone always comes back to it, so it just shows.
No, you can't, but you don't leave it alone, you don't disappear from it. But it wasn't, I think, I've never felt like pushing it to go out and form a band and go on the road and things like that. I get that urge, I must admit, I've done that for years. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that. And then you think, oh, shit, I'm working 7 days a week. I can't fit this in, I can't commit, so no. But now I've got the time, to do these things, and I'm hoping now that things will pick up. I've been involved with a charity, which is for mental health. They call it like music therapists with a team of volunteers, and we'd do anything.
I think we should hear your second song now. And this is actually one that you said earlier that you like to do a bit of composing and a bit of dabbling and that sort of thing. And this is a song that you've written, isn't it? But you haven't got a name for it.
Yeah, no title. I don't know what I'll call it. this is quite, it's coincidentally, because I chose Dirty Old Town for the first song. This is a similar thing. This was my daughter was working for a film and TV company in Manchester as a PA. And I needed a new production studio. And they ended up looking at several buildings and they bought an old mill in Manchester. I went down when they bought this and I fell in love with it right away. I said, oh my God, this is eerie, you know. And I'm staring around all these walls and the architecture and the floors. And I said, I wonder what happened in here, you know. And we found out it was a textile mill, obviously, because that's what we were famous for in Manchester. And I was just stood there imagining all the noise and the activity that would be going on there, you know, and now absolute silence and crumbling walls and all. They did it up and they're in there and they've got a production suite and a recording studio and everything. So I came home and I just wrote a few things about, like poetry, really, and it ended up as a song. So that's what it's about, what we've lost in the Industrial Revolution. And
yeah,
that's what that song's about. And hopefully, if anybody's got any ideas for a title, then come on. But it's one of those I think I'll probably go back and forward to and probably add more verses.
If anyone has a title, write it in the comments.
Yeah.
And Geoff will see if one of them fits.
Yeah. You never know. I might think, why didn't I think of that?
Let's have a listen.
Behind our city streets, there lies a story. Of times we never knew, from way back when. Where once our buildings stood, in all their glory. The workhouse of our women and our men. But now they stand in silence, all forgotten. Their walls hold memories they may never tell. Our famous city once crowned the king of cotton. Where are people long before us? They did dwell. I wish that I could go back for just one moment. And live the life they lived in for myself. Where the things they built for us would last forever. But now, sadly, all that's left upon the shelf. The long lost mining towns, now in the distance. Those men who risk their lives for all to see. Where our fathers and grandfathers gone before us left all they ever had for you and me. Those days, may they be history forever. Though looking back, they're not so very far. They gave us all our future here together, and they made us the people we are. I wish that I could go back for just one moment. See the life they lived in for myself. Where those things they built for us would last forever. But now sadly, all that's left upon the ship. Now sadly, all's been left upon the ship.
Brilliant. Thank you, Geoff. So you mentioned previously your charity work. Could you go into a bit more detail on that? Like, what was your role in that music therapy sort of situation?
Well, how I came across it, I met a friend of mine that was just walking in where I live here in Chorley, Manchester, and we had a walk, and he said, I'm just going to get my cycle fixed. He's a bike collector. He's got a few road bikes, you know. He said, I'm just going to get it fixed. There's a guy at the charity hub up here that has a unit where he does the bikes up for the kids and that. And so I said, oh, I'll walk up with you. And behind it is like a big old, real big old sort of Victorian house set back off the road. And there was loads of people in and out and up these steps and in and out and the door banging. I said, what's going on in the house? He said, oh, that's part of the charity. I'm just the bike man. This is what they do, everything in there. So I said, like what? He said, well, you name it. I thought, can I go in? He said, go in and have a chat. So I went in and had a look round, and they were doing all sorts. There was art classes on, and there was computers going, and there was people reading poetry, and there was another room with drama club. And I said, like, I'll probably get involved with something. I've got a bit of time on my hands now. And before I knew it, well, I got to the door and I said, I'll see you next week. I'll call in. And the guy said, oh, by the way, we've got a recording studio downstairs in the cellar.
Oh, wow.
Really? He says, yes. So I said, could I have a look? And I went down and had a look. And I said, what goes on in here? And he said, well, not a lot. We hire it out and for free. People can use the equipment. If you've got any ideas to start anything up, then by all means. So between us all, anyway, at the end of that, between volunteers over a few weeks, we started up like a guitar group. I started up a ukulele beginners club. We got together like a session for recording just people that have never sang before as a group or a choir, if you like. And we had Sound Explorers was running, which is just free for all, everything. We just used to set up recording machines and the computer, and people could just pick anything up and make a noise or sing or shout or bang about, and then we play it back. And I find that quite interesting because it's what I do in my studio upstairs. I use different sounds from anything, you know, anything falling on the floor or a piece of glass smashing, and then they edit it and try and make a big massive sound out of it.
Oh, wow.
Try and make orchestral sort of pieces out of it. So we did all those kind of projects, and we ended up then getting funded by the lottery, but a bit, not for the volunteers, but for the charity itself, for mental health. And they started funding and bringing in some professional people and composers and things like that. And what that did, they do short classes and short courses with us, volunteers. I've been on one or two electronics courses for synthesizers, things like that. And they give us basic information that then we can pass on and start a group for the people that we're, you know, teaching or learning or getting involved with, if you like. So we pass it on at a very basic level. We don't have to have any great knowledge or ability, if you like. So quite an interesting project, yeah.
What was the charity called?
It's Blue Sky in Trafford, which is next to Manchester.
It's so admirable doing that, though, spending your time.
It gives me a lot rather than me giving them a lot as well.
Yeah.
People always say, oh, that's a great thing to do. I said, yeah, but I'm not giving it all away. I'm gaining a hell of a lot from that as well, believe me. You know, you don't have to be struggling, as some of them are, with mental health or have issues. There's a big return from it, really. You know, monetary wouldn't do it, I don't think. It'd be a chore then, because you think it's a wages and I've got to do it. I do it because I want to do it. And so do the others, you know. That's all it's about.
Absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah. Well, should we hear your third song? I Like Ukuleles. Well, I think that it's about time that we talk about something that at Homestage we're really excited to present. And Geoff is going to be hosting our first ever instrument-focused folk club. And it's called the Ukulele String Along Workshop. Geoff, could you tell us a bit about it?
I first bought a ukulele probably 3 years ago. The story, I've told this loads of time, because people say, how did you think of buying one, or why do you want one, or have you played one before? I got a Christmas card off my in-laws. They do it every year, and it was 50 quid cash for a Christmas present. And it lay in the drawer for, like, till April. And my wife said, your Christmas card's still here, like, with your money in, you know. And she said, what are you doing with it? I said, I have no idea. Give us me 50 quid, like. And I had it in my pocket and I went to town. And I always call in, we've got a massive Dawson's music here, famous music store in Manchester. And I know all the lads in there. I called in for a chat. And there's a guy in the corner playing the ute. And I thought, crikey, they're good. And I said, how much is that? So he said, 59 quid. And ooh, I've got 50 quid, you know. So anyway, to cut a long story short, I ended up buying a ukulele. And I've not really studied it or anything like that. I just play basic sort of, you know, strumming songs and stuff like that. But I decided to introduce it to the charity that we were talking about earlier. And we got involved and got a ukulele club together. And I thought, why not suggest this to Homestage when I was involved with the folk club? And you very kindly sort of took it on board. Let's hope that something comes of it. And the idea is, really, during lockdown especially, there are so many. There must be hundreds of them online. But what I'm finding is they're all the same. They're all taking the same songs and nicking each other's catalogue of songs and song sheets. And it just seems to be the same strum pattern, the same timing. Nothing wrong with that if that's what people want to do. But to be honest, it's getting to the stage where I'm thinking, oh, I'm not looking in there again. I can't be bothered with it. And I thought I could do something different and sort of chat about, have a bit of chat about ukulele, the different styles of it, the different tunings, the different sort of ideas you can do, the different styles you can play on it. It's just a very versatile instrument, and I thought, let's give it a go and see if people want to get involved. So hopefully, putting the ukulele string along together, we'll get some people involved. It can be from beginners to, I mean, if we've got any experts, I'd love them, because they might teach me and I can step back, just introduce it and then learn from them. If people want to get involved and say, for the next one, at the end of every meeting, we could say, for the next one, shall we all try and learn a Lennon and McCartney song? Or shall we all try and learn a folk song? We don't have to say which one it is, because then we'll get a few different ones. Mm. And then if people are interested and they don't like to play it, we can say, right, that's our next project. Let's all try and learn how to play that. If they want to do that, if they want to do something else, they may ask questions. They may want information rather than the tunes at first. Well, that's fine. It's wide open, as you just said. So,
brilliant.
Yeah.
Thanks, Geoff.
That's a good idea.
Thank you. So the first session is on the 9th of June at 7 p.m, I believe. And yeah, if you want to be involved, sign up to the mailing list below and you'll get all the information you need. So don't forget to do that. And don't forget to send in any song titles for Geoff that you might have thought about, because we'd love to see them. Thank you so much for joining us today, Geoff. It's been brilliant. Let's listen to Geoff's final song. Geoff, it's called Killing the Blues. I think it's one of my favourites. Could you tell us a bit about it?
Killing the Blues, I always imagined, I've heard it for years, I always imagined it was a very old song. I heard it first, I think, on a album by Robert Plant and Alison Krauss, Raining Sands. Beautiful album. And it was quite a diversion from his rock days, you know, Led Zepp and stuff. But I was fascinated by his voice, and I was fascinated by the format and the harmonies. It was such a beautiful song, and I thought, God, that's got to be an old sort of traditional folky song or something. And I found out that it was only written, I think, in 2005 by a bass player, Roland Sally. That was the bass player with Chris Isaac, that was quite a famous musician a while ago. And he did a solo album. I think it was a solo album called Killing the Blues, and that was a title track, obviously. But Robert Plant, I read that he was driving home in Hertfordshire, I think it was. He was driving home one night from a gig, and he said, this came on the radio, he said, and it's one of those songs I just had to pull in at the side of the road. And he must have heard Roland Sally singing. And he said, I just sat there and I was absolutely gobsmacked, and I thought, I've got to record that. And I suggested it to somebody, and he said, well, Alison Krauss is looking to record it, and she's named you as the sort of, you know, the co. And he said, I'd love to do it. And whichever way, one of them went over to the other, and they ended up with doing the album as well as the song. But yeah, it's a fabulous song. And I just do a very simple version here for this particular thing. But I've just finished doing it in my studio upstairs, a full with like drum machines and keyboards and synths. A full version is done without the vocal. So I'm intending to do the two vocals or the three vocals, harmonies and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So that's my next project. It'll be a full thing. But obviously for the purpose of this session, it was just a guitar and a simple format, simple one voice. But lovely song, brilliant song. Love it.
Thanks, Geoff. Let's hear it.
Just like embers in colors red and gold, they set us on fire, burning just like a movie in our eyes. Somebody said they saw me swinging. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Geoff. Honestly, it's been wonderful to talk to you, and I'm so excited for the ukulele club. I honestly can't advise you enough to give it a go and come along. It's going to be so much fun. I'll be there, certainly. I can't wait to learn all about the ukulele and even give it a go. So I hope to see a lot of you there. I should probably mention that our Tuesday Folk People sessions are now going from fortnightly to weekly. So our next session is next week on the 8th of June. And we're going to be welcoming Terry St. Clair and Gemma Kawaja. For more information, keep an eye on our social media and our website, or sign up to our mailing list if you haven't already, and you'll get all updates on our future events. So thank you, Celtic Conundrum. Thank you, Geoff Wilson. It's been a wonderful session, and see you all next week.